All right, thank you for joining us in X Garage today. We are here. Well, I am in my basement. Ethan is somewhere much more magical, and Heath is in the most magical of all places. I was actually going to make a Lucky Charms reference, and then realized that that was actually Irish. So you are in the least magical of all places, which is in Scotland.
Well, yeah. Hanging out with William Wallace and
so
Harry
Queen of welcome to X Garage from the not so lucky part of the world. Or is it? What do you mean? What's the Irish? Oh, the Irish. Oh, I just missed it, didn't I?
Yeah.
I'm just across the other pond from them.
Yeah. So I have been discovering some interesting things about some of their composers. There's not a ton of them that I was able to find, but there's a good handful. Especially at the change of the century. So prior to this, we were in the Romantic period. So a lot of these composers are kind of in that transition period from the 19th century to the 20th century. I'd like to start with a guy named Dane Rudhyar. say his name that way.
I'm gonna name my second child that, if that ever happens.
Rudhyar.
Just something obnoxious where Rudder. You can't pronounce it.
Something like that. Anyway, so he's an American writer, composer, artist, and astrologer. So his compositions, like, they kind of range from a little bit more normal sounding, and there's some that get a little bit more esoteric, let's say. But beyond just composing, he really was very committed to writing and doing lots of things. So I'll read a couple sections in his this is the theosophy.wiki, which is an interesting resource for sure. So Dane, who has contributed generously to the American Theosophist through the years, guessing that's their magazine, was recently awarded an honorary degree of Doctor in Humane Letters from J.F. Kennedy. Mm. And an honorary degree of Doctor in Transpersonal Philosophy by the California Institute of Transpersonal Psychology. And
Menlo Park. Popular right now, I'm sure.
Yeah. Yep. So Dane has published more than 40 books and hundreds of articles, most concerning astrology and spirituality. So a guy named Claude wrote, Rudhyar is a man of profound and penetrating vision whose writings can cast an illumination upon life.
And it's actually, Superman. He's kind of like a Superman. He's got that penetrating vision. That's cool.
Yes.
Yes. You got to have that if you're in the theosophy movement.
Yeah.
Cool. Oh, and one thing, since we're using Zoom now, I know how to share the sound. So we should all be able to listen to this.
Roberto.
Oh, that's not him. Not him. Robert. Okay.
I was like, that's close to my name.
Yeah. So this is their the first title.
Look at that artwork.
I know. Yeah. Isn't that interesting?
Very, very symmetrical.
looks like Satan, man.
Exactly.
Like the light coming from the head. Like, do you see that?
The light.
It looks kind of like the third eye or some kind of representation of that.
Yeah, and the hands, almost like a praying set of hands into this light of an eye, and it's wearing a nice necklace, not kind of with feathers coming off of it.
Isn't this the Sanskrit thing right there? The center of the
The Om. Yeah. You can actually see the star, I think, right above the you can see there's symbology
thing at the bottom.
Anyway, let's listen to some of this music. Can you hear that?
Oh, yeah. Yes.
Yeah, it's like a waltz.
Beautiful start.
What I hear first is that note that kind of, that single note.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Oof. Like a David Lynch sci-fi.
Yeah.
I'm feeling kind of trancey.
Yeah. To write music for the movie Dune.
Yeah. So not super abnormal for our ears. I think.
I wouldn't put it in on a jog.
Yeah.
You might think like zombies or someone will start falling over.
Yeah. I'd be looking over my shoulder every two steps.
this isn't good running music, Heath.
I don't listen to me running, but I tell you, I would not listen to that.
I just wanted to point out a couple more of the art pieces that are on the front of his, I think these are some of his books. He's an interesting fella, really into the astrology and such. The other guy I wanted to point out was, I find this guy fascinating. I think his music is genuinely beautiful. But his thoughts about music are
genuinely grotesque, can you say? Or...
Not grotesque. Not in that sense.
Okay.
So he... are you guys familiar with... It's called... I always forget the name of it, but here it is. It's synesthesia.
It's where
you see colors associated with sound. So some people, when they hear music, they actually see different colors. So it's an odd phenomena that some people do experience. I'm not among them. Sometimes it's associated with different keys. Some people might see the key of B flat might sound pink to you or something like that. But anyway, he associated the circle of fifths and gave it a color wheel. And he had some very so we can find.
It's kind of like a onomatopoeia, but with words, but yeah. Now with art and color.
I guess a little bit, yeah.
Like deriving something from something. It's like blood would be red, but yeah. Music would be kind of like the death sound. I don't know.
Anyway, he wanted to he never finished it, but like at the end of his life he wanted to be able to write something that would be no less than the absolute transformation of people to a higher spiritual level. He wanted to write it that like it would be a composition that would last days.
So let's get this straight. The composition itself would be this kind of this piece that could help you transcend into another spiritual
right
dimension, really, a level.
Yep.
Heightened spirituality.
Yep.
Kind of like Handel's Messiah kind of deal, or am I treading some dangerous waters there?
Yeah. Handel's Messiah was necessarily, I don't think, had that same intention. I have questions about Handel himself, but he was still writing in the Christian context.
I mean, this goes to your point from the other episode where the ideas of their, that revelation that was given to them through their dictated sources of spiritual higher knowledge is really becomes their influence in how they're even creating their art.
So here's
like you're saying, that's confessionally what they're doing.
Yep. So here's what I wanted to point out. So Scriabin developed a mystic chord or superimposed fourths. So normally chords are built on thirds. I believe this would be built on fourths. I mean, other people have done similar things, but it does have this kind of very odd sound to it. And like Wagner, he believed in the total artwork He saw music as a means of transforming humanity by hurrying on its spiritual evolution.
By what? What did you say? Hurrying?
Yeah, music as a means of transforming humanity by hurrying on its spiritual evolution.
Wow. Isn't patience a part of love? Aren't they all about love and this higher? I mean, yeah. It seems kind of strange for love to hurry. Right. Just weird.
What are our spirits evolving into? That's what my question is. Like, yeah. How do we know?
To the point. That's good. Yeah. Exactly. Exactly. If that evolution isn't coming by means of the spirit regenerating, restoring your relationship to God and sanctifying you through through life, then that transcending is a bunch of.
We know it through Hegel didactics. That's how you get there. You
keep on. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, Hegel. Okay. Hegel.
Yeah, that makes sense.
You have a thesis, antithesis, and synthesis, and you keep on
that's doing right
that ad infinitum until you become the ultimate person.
I think I wonder if Hegel actually had the same dictation guy named DK.
Yeah. That's okay. So here's
his music, to Roberto.
Yep.
Okay.
That's the pianist. This is the composer, Alexander. Okay. This is Fantasy in B minor, Opus 28. Play with too much more of that. I actually very much like that.
No, that was more enjoyable. Yeah.
I
mean, and the other one was great too.
What's your
movie score? But yeah.
What's your thoughts on that piece, Jake?
I think that it sounds like it may align with his goal of transcending through music. So I think there's a lot of emotion in there that he's putting into his pieces. So I guess you
kind of hear the dun, 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 like he's like stepping up into a next level. Yeah.
Yep.
I don't know.
Right. That's funny. And yet you can't. And yet it's all music.
Yeah.
it's just. But you're right. I noticed that as well. I thought that it was like, again, trying to escape. Almost again reality, but you can't.
Yep.
It's like you can distort and become disorderly, which then you lose that greater beauty. I would argue. Mm-hmm. I think it's objective, but anyhow,
like there's moments of chaos, and then he kind of would come back into. Sort of like a more even in the moments.
And that's more I mean they're all writing as men of their time, so I don't want to make it sound like they're totally outside of the transitional period from the Romantic era to the modern era. They are, but their goals kind of behind the music I think are fascinating. This I found a bit more directionless, but interesting. So this is called Essay in Modes.
Quick question, Jake. Like, so is modes like a musical term?
Yep. So
okay.
Modes. Yeah. Modes is a, they are a set of scales. They were
okay, traditionally, hear that ding, ding, ding.
They were traditionally, they were traditionally used in old church music. So the set was Ionian, Dorian, Phrygian, Lydian. We normally use just major or minor, but these are kind of variations in between major and minor. A good way to think about it is if you look at a piano, if you play every white key, C to C is the Ionian or major scale. Mm-hmm. And then D to D, all white keys, that's the Dorian scale. So he's playing some chords on or some harmonies on top of those. I haven't taken the time to analyze this, but what I did find interesting, if you zoom into the score, I'm not entirely sure what his purpose in writing this was. It may have just been an academic exercise, but the time signature is very weird, abnormal. 11:08.
No. Yeah, I was thinking 11:08. That's crazy. Yeah.
And then the key signature is abnormal as well. Huh. So that's not like a traditional key signature.
Yeah. It's weird how you have so many flats in there.
And then you have a double flat right here.
Yeah.
So that means that this B note is actually an A.
Huh.
So I'm not super familiar with this key signature. I haven't seen it before.
It's very lengthy.
Yep. So I'm sure some more skilled theorists will be able to tell me why, but I do find that like the massive amounts of odd like is this extremely necessary for this sort of piece? I don't think so.
Who are you to say that? It's their work of art. It's their it's their sound that they want to make.
Completely subjective. Yeah.
But I could be wrong. Somebody could tell me why that would be. I just think this is interestingly written.
So the individual behind this piece was a Theosophist.
That's what they are claiming on the Theosophist Society's Wikipedia page. Okay. So here's a list of composers. This is John Foltz.
I was just going to ask you how you felt those extra notes or notations there would maybe be related to what he's trying to do with his worldview.
There is less of, not as much information on him. He is an English composer and Theosophist. His cousin described John Foltz of England, who has raised the Requiem from the grave and made it once more a voice of praise for those who found the dying way to life. I have no idea what that means. The dying way to life. So I think these are old enough. I don't think that we're going to get pinged for copyright or anything like that. So hopefully I didn't play too much of those. If not, we can cut those out. But anyway, their music is interesting, and there's interesting philosophical trends behind the music that I think shed some light on how they see things. It's not as, in my mind, it's not as crazy as some of the art that is associated with the group. Though there is some of that, especially from Dane. Good old Dane Rudhir.
Rudhir.
Yep. Cool.
How would you see some of that what would identify these individuals in their music? How has that some of that come up into music today? And maybe we could save that for another episode.
I'm not entirely sure. They all so far seem like men of their time. So I don't think that this. I mean, same with the artists. Like there is definitely some of that influence. I'm not convinced that any one of these people were influential enough to be massively changing in the musical arena. But I do think it's interesting the way that they saw the music that they were playing and how they approached it from a compositional standpoint.
Okay, very good.
Cool. Awesome. Well, let's stop this episode. A little short one for you here today. And we're going to get working on the next one regarding the Theosophical Society.
Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for joining us on X Garage.
X Garage. Thank you.